So we made a few videos about relativity, and we've talked about how distances change in relativity. We've talked about how time changes in relativity. So I thought I'd talk about something which combines those two things together, which is how speed, which is distance divided by time, changes in relativity. The previous videos we made, we called a gamma trilogy because they all had this gamma factor in it. Actually, one of the interesting things about the way speed transforms is that the gammas all disappear. They all cancel out. So there is no gamma in this gamma video. So we need to think about how you measure speed. As I say, it's distance divided by time, but particularly how it changes depending on what reference frame you're in. So we need to think about how different people measure speed in different reference frames. And so the classic kind of thought experiment you might do is you've got somebody on a train, and we'll call, what should we call this reference frame? S prime. And they're going to roll a bowling ball along the train at some speed or other. And the train itself is moving, so this whole reference frame is moving, if you like, in this direction at some other speed, V. And so the way on the train you'd measure the speed is that you'd see how far the bowling ball had gone in your reference frame. What should we call this? Delta X, how far it's gone. Prime, because it's in your reference frame. And at what time, you know, at some, you'd measure that at some time, delta T prime, after you'd let go of the ball. And then you could actually measure the speed in your reference frame of that bowling ball. It's just how far it's gone divided by the time it took to get there. Like, that's the definition of speed, is how far something's gone divided by the amount of time it took to get there is the definition of speed. So that's in one reference frame. So then the question is, what does the person in this reference frame, the other reference frame, see? And let's deal with a non-relativistic case first. Okay, so what are they going to measure? The distance that they'll measure that ball has gone is going to be how far the bowling ball's rolled away from you, plus how far you've moved down the line. That extra distance, how far the train has moved, depends on, well, that's basically how fast the train was going.
You're sort of adding it all on top of each other.
Yeah, exactly, that's all you're doing. So that distance is V delta T. The train's going at some speed V, and it's traveled for some time delta T, then the distance it's covered is just the speed times the time it's taken to do it. So now we can put all this stuff together that says that delta X is equal to, so how far you see the ball as having moved is how far the train's moved plus how far the ball has moved relative to the train, just the sum of the two. And we can rearrange this in non-relativistic case to say that, let's just divide through, delta x divided by delta t is equal to v plus delta x prime divided by delta t. And in this non-relativistic case, we don't have to worry about different people seeing different times, so it doesn't matter whether that's delta t or delta t prime, we can call it the same thing, it's all the same thing. Or we can rewrite this again, that just says that the speed that you see the balls moving is equal to v, so that's delta x by delta t, plus the speed that the person on the train sees the ball moving. And that, as you said, is just basically you just add the speeds, right? The speed at which the bowling ball is moving is the speed that the ball is moving relative to the train plus the speed that the train is moving relative to you, right? That's the simple Galilean transformation, no relativity. Everything works sensibly in the way we're used to it working. The reason why people get interested in this is that one of the things that everyone says in relativity is you can't ever travel faster than light. And so one obvious question you could ask is, well, why can't I just get to travel faster than light by doing these kind of additions? In that, if supposing instead of rolling a bowling ball, the person on the train was actually shining a torch along the train, then the torch beam would be traveling at the speed of light relative to them. And then if you ask, well, how fast would the torch beam then be traveling relative to you? Well, it would be the speed of light plus the speed that the train's moving away from you, and that's faster than the speed of light.
Done it, okay. You've hacked exactly. The universe.
It's sorted. Unfortunately, relativity takes care of that, and it's not really the way that things work. So we need to start again, but we need to now do the problem properly with relativity.
Is this your minute physics audition, Professor?
Unfortunately, my drawing is not quite up to the job, I suspect. And then we got the other chap sitting here, moving along at some speed V. Okay, now previously the formula we had said that the distance the bowling ball is down the line is equal to the distance on relative to the train plus how far the train's moved. Now, what the extra factor that we haven't put in yet is special relativity. And as we saw before, what special relativity does is introduces these factors of gamma. And so this Galilean transformation that we had before is a little bit modified by an extra factor of gamma in front of it. Gamma is 1 over the square root of 1 minus v squared over c squared. And we have a whole series of videos you can go and watch about gamma, should you wish to do so. But then the other thing we know about relativity is that not only does the distance depend on what reference frame you're in, but actually the time depends on what reference frame you're in. And so we need the equivalent transformation for that. So there are these things called Lorentz transformations. That's the first of them. And then this is the other Lorentz transformation we need. Turns out these are the two Lorentz transformations you need. Okay, so now we can say, okay, so what's the speed as measured from the person who's standing beside the track watching the train go by? And we just do the same thing that we did before. The speed is just the distance divided by the time. So we can just divide them. We end up with delta x divided by delta t is equal to, now the gammas are going to cancel, because if we divide that by the other, we end up with a gamma on the top and a gamma on the bottom, so we can just cancel them out. And I'll do a little bit of tidying up. I'll divide top and bottom through by delta t prime, so I can just write this as delta x prime over delta t prime. This is kind of the answer that we wanted, because delta x over delta t is the speed of the bowling ball or whatever it is that's being thrown along the train as seen from the person standing beside the track. And delta x prime over delta t prime is the speed as seen by the person on the train. So I can write that in terms of the u's and u primes that we had before. This just says that u is equal to u prime plus v divided by 1 plus, that's a u prime again, v over c squared, which is the final answer. In the non-relativistic limit, so what we were looking at before, the Galilean transformation, so if both u prime and v are small compared to the speed of light, that means this term is small, so this thing's just one, basically. And that just says that the speed you see is just the sum of the speed of the ball relative to the train and the train relative to you, which is the answer we had before. So that's right, it all kind of comes out right if things aren't close to the speed of light. But okay, but now let's do the more interesting case of actually where the relativity really matters. And in particular, let's go to the really extreme case of actually instead of rolling a bowling ball along the train, let's shine a light beam along the train. So in that case, u prime, the speed of the whatever it is relative to the train, is equal to the speed of light. And let's see what happens when we put that in there. So in that case, we end up with, if u prime is equal to the speed of light, then u is equal to, u prime is just the speed of light, plus v divided by 1 plus, u prime is the speed of light, cv over c squared. Now let me just do a little bit of playing around with this. So I'll rewrite the top here as C into 1, so pull that factor out, plus V over C. Because if I multiply this out, I just end up with C plus CV over C, which is just V, so C plus V, divided by, and then all I'm going to do here is cancel the C over C squared, so I end up with 1 plus V over C, which you'll notice is just the same as the term there. So this is the same as that, which just basically means that this whole thing is just equal to the speed of light still. So there's the bizarre thing that we've taken. Remember what we've done here is said, okay, so there's a light beam that's moving relative to the train at the speed of light. Now, if you're watching from beside the train, what speed do you see that light beam going at? The answer is still the speed of light. You haven't actually added to its speed at all. And I guess the physics behind it is that actually you really have to worry about both space and time being changed by what reference frame you're in, which means that, not surprisingly, the speed that comes out at the end is going to be changed in a slightly strange way as well. And it turns out that relativity takes care of this invariance of the speed of light, that no matter what reference frame you're watching a light beam travel from, you'll always see it traveling at the speed of light.
Is the universe wanting to keep things at the speed of light and everything changes to cater for that? Or does everything change all the time and the speed of light just falls out of that? Is it chicken or egg?
It's a very good question, and I actually really like your first explanation, that actually the universe arranges things in such a way that the speed of light always comes out as the speed of light. And no matter how much you mess around with things by trying to run away from a light beam or run towards it, when you come to measure its speed, you'll always find that its speed comes out as the speed of light. And everything else kind of adjusts. The distances and the times adjust in just such a way so that when you come to combine those distances and times to measure a speed for a light beam, it will always come out as the speed of light.
Is there something that is important about the speed of light being constant and unchanging? So
what motivated Einstein to come up with all of this in the first place is he had this idea that the laws of physics should be the same whatever reference frame you're in. So if you're in a sealed box, there should be no experiment you can do that will tell you whether that sealed box is moving at a constant speed or is stationary. And in fact, it's even, in his view of things, a kind of a meaningless question. And what he also knew is that the speed of light comes out from the laws of electromagnetism. And so then the question is, okay, so but in what reference frame do those laws of physics work? And his argument is that those laws of physics should work in whatever reference frame you're in, which means that actually the speed of light has to be invariant if you believe that the laws of physics are the same in all the different reference frames.
What if it hadn't been that way? What if the universe had said, nah, that can be different for different reference frames? Would you and I be ripped to pieces in some cosmic rip, or would the universe just be a bit different and quirky? Like, does the universe benefit from the fact this is what happens?
It's very hard to construct a universe in which this wasn't true. In retrospect, it's hard to construct a universe in which this isn't true. Bear in mind that, for example, you know, all the other things that come from relativity kind of flow from that. So think famous things like E equals mc squared all flow from this invariance of the speed of light. And that means that the equivalence of mass to energy is actually a natural consequence of relativity. And so, for example, what powers the sun, fusion, converting mass into energy, wouldn't work. And if we weren't living in a relativistic universe, now you could imagine that the universe, the laws of physics in such a universe would come up with some other way of generating, you know, energy from fusion, but the picture we currently have of it really would be completely different.
And the quantity of the speed of light, the speed that it actually is, does that matter? Like, would the universe be the same if the speed of light had been halved, or it was quite, you know, if it was something close to the speed we walk at? Like, does it need to be as fast as it is to our human brains?
So it comes out of the laws of electromagnetism. So it's to do with how strong electric fields are, how strong magnetic fields are, which are really just arbitrary constants of nature, as far as we know, which means that actually the speed of light, which is some combination of these things, is also an arbitrary law of nature. The universe would be a very strange place if the speed of light were very much slower, because, of course, all these relativistic effects that lead to all the weird things that come out of relativity, we don't usually have to worry about them in everyday life. But if it actually turned out that the speed of light, you know, was walking pace, then all sorts of strange relativistic effects would happen every time you walked to the postbox. You know, you would have to worry about all the relativistic time dilation and length contraction effects.
So it'd be like, if I go and post this letter, am I going to die before I get there?
Will all your relatives have died of old age before you get home again? So yes, indeed, it would be a very, very strange universe. So the light, instead of going straight up and down, follows a path like that. So it has further to go. From our perspective, that light's gone further. But also, the speed of light is the same in every reference frame.